This conference will now be recorded.
Anybody try to practice what we did yesterday?
Yes, Rishi.
Okay. So since there are no questions, we'll proceed with stuff yesterday. So we talked about properties. We discussed like what are the different properties that are available, versioning, server access logging, static website hosting, object lock, tags. So we discussed all of this. We talked about permissions. What are these, like public access, access control, list, bucket policy and all. Then we looked into lifecycle rules. So apart from lifecycle rules, we have like replication, we have analytics, we have metrics, we have inventory. What is replication? So replication is, if I want to replicate the contents, make an exact copy of whatever is there in my bucket with another bucket. Okay, I want to simply copy the contents of my bucket with another bucket. Now this bucket could be in the same region, this bucket could be in a different region, this bucket could be in the same account, this bucket could be in a different account. Okay, so if I say add rule, so versioning needs to be enabled for this to happen. Okay, so I'll say enable versioning entire bucket. Okay, then I'll say next. Then what is the destination bucket, where I want to copy, where I want to make a copy, whether it's in the same account, whether this is in a different account. So if this is in a different account, I need to enter the account ID and the bucket name. If it is in the same account, I simply need to search for the bucket. So I have this bucket, which is another bucket from this. So this is CF templates. I have another bucket. I can select this. Okay, once I select this, I can say, so versioning needs to be enabled in both buckets. And once I enable versioning in both buckets, I'll simply say next and configure them. What that will done is, what it will do is it will start copying any object that is uploaded in this bucket. Anything that is uploaded over here will get its copy created in the other bucket. Okay, that is replication. Earlier, it only supported cross-region replication. Later on, they came up with same region replication also. So now I can replicate anywhere I want. Now this anywhere can be your account, my account, any other account. Okay, so no restrictions as of now. Okay. Analytics. So analytics, if I say add a rule, a filter, okay, leave empty for entire bucket, or I can export data. This does this present me a picture like which storage class is being utilized and how much. Okay, say I am storing data in S3 standard, I'm storing data in S3 IA, I may be storing data in Glacier, I may be pushing data into RRS. So depending on where my data goes, if I enable analytics, I will be able to get those details over here. So it will create me a graph. So you can enable storage class analytics for the entire bucket. Okay, and then it will show me a graph like S3 standard is this much GB, S3 IA is this much terabytes, Glacier is this much petabytes, whatever is the use case, it will show me as a good graph format. So this is to analyze how, which storage class I'm using and how I'm using those storage classes. Metrics is something similar. So how metrics works is it shows me how many requests are coming, what is the amount of data transfer happening, and how is the replication being managed. Okay, analytics watch was which storage class is being utilized, how much. Metrics is how much requests are coming for data, how is the data transfer happening, how is the replication happening. So if I select one day, or it is not enabled, there is no filter, it will start showing me graphs. 1 hour, 3 hour, 12 hours, 1 day, 1 week. Okay, so say if I select 3 hours, so in the past 3 hours, which storage class, how much request came, what was the data transfer, whether I have enabled replication or not, all those details will be shown to me as graphs. Okay, so it's not showing anything because it is not enabled. So I have to add a filter And based on that, it is going to show me like number of objects, bucket size bytes, and all those stuff. It will start displaying over here. Okay, total size, object count, all that stuff it will show me. Right. Similarly, for requests, like how many get requests, how many put requests, how many post requests, okay, how many download requests, all that stuff. Data transfer will be like how much data was uploaded, how much data was downloaded, all those details. Okay, and replication is when I have enabled replication, then only this metric will come up, else it won't show anything over here. We have something called as an inventory, which is again something very similar to log, how analytics and metrics works. Okay, so I can receive a file or an object daily basis for the entire bucket. Okay, so this is something where it combines analytics and metrics and start showing details like this storage class has this bucket is being stored in this storage class. These are the number of objects in it. Who is the owner of these objects? Whether versioning is enabled or not, and all that stuff. So inventory is something where it starts showing data, which is kind of a mixture of analytics and metrics. Okay, so all three of these options are to analyze or to get details about your S3 buckets. Okay, S3 buckets, S3 objects, storage classes, and all. So this helps to keep an eye on like how your storage is being utilized, how much charges you are being billed into, and whether you can save any amount or not. So all those stuffs can be mentioned over. Okay. Any doubts in management? Okay. So access points is something which this we'll discuss deep when we go into networking. I'll give you an overview. Okay, so what happens is whenever say I'm running an EC2 instance, so my EC2 instance, when it accesses S3, when my EC2 instance tries to upload or download something from the S3, the request goes via the internet. Okay, it doesn't use the AWS private network or doesn't use the AWS backbone network. By default, any request that comes from the EC2 instance goes via the internet. Now, sending requests to S3 via the internet could pose like a few issues. One of the common issues is like security risk. Okay, then if internet is not working, if you don't have access to the internet, you cannot access S3, and all those issues starts popping up. But when you use the private network of AWS or the backbone network of AWS, there is no requirement of sending data over the internet. Data can simply traverse through the backbone network and it becomes secure. The data transfer is fast. You are not billed for data going out of AWS. Okay, so it adds it gives a lot of benefits. Okay. So what we do is we can create an access point, say whether this is a VPN or an internet via internet access point. So this is block public access and all this stuff. We can give it a name, okay, and create a policy ARN. So policy ARN is same as the policy we saw yesterday, and we can say create an access point. Now, when this access point is created, instead of, we'll have to change, make a small change in the VPC configuration, which we will talk about when we are discussing VPC. Okay, the next topic is going to be VPC, by the way. So we'll see how this can be set up and how we can introduce or how we can add this in our routing table so that our requests to S3 flow via the access point and not via the internet. Okay. So this is access point. Access points is related to how an S3 bucket is being accessed. All the other stuff was like encryption, permissions, and management. Okay. Any doubts up till now? So this is mostly all about S3. I'll show you a small demo on how to automate a few things, but this should be clear. Then only we'll go to the demo.
Rishi, this access point, anyway, we are accessing this object file, right? What is the specialty in this one? You said that either by VPC or the internet, but right now we are using like accessing, right, that objects. So without this also you are accessing.
Right now you are accessing via the internet. With the access point, the communication happens via the AWS backbone network. Okay, and if you select internet there, the communication will happen over an encrypted network. Currently, there's nothing of that sort. Anything that is happening happens over the internet. There is no encryption put in. There is no security in the data transfer that is happening.
Okay.
Okay. Yeah. Any other questions? Okay. So I'll show you a small example of a basic level of an application. What this application is going to do is this application is written in PHP. Now, why PHP? Because when I created it, it was easier to write in PHP. Okay. No hard and fast rules. You can write the application in whatever language you are comfortable with. If you are not comfortable with, that is fine. I share the application code with you and you can use it to test it out. The idea of the fundamentals behind this small application demo is to give you an idea that to download something or whatever it is doing, then in that case, how the configuration will be handled and how the data uploads, data downloads will be happening, we'll be seeing with this. Okay. Am I audible?
Yeah, now audible, but before it was blank actually.
It was paused for some time.
It was
pause for some times, like 10 to 15 seconds.
Okay. So I'll explain again. What I was saying is I'll show you a small application setup. The purpose of this are the what the application is doing is the application will connect to S3. It will create a bucket into S3, then create a file into that bucket, and then it will show you the contents of that file. Okay. Now the application which I am showing you has been written in PHP. Okay, why PHP? Because it was easier to write in PHP. Okay, no other use case, no other reason why it is written in PHP. Okay, it is just to give you an idea that if you have an application in your product which is communicating with S3, maybe uploading something, maybe downloading something, so how that setup will work or how that setup is going to go through, that is to help you get an idea on that. I'll show you how this application is going to be set up or how this application is going to be working. Okay, now the application is written in PHP. This is a web-based application and this will be using Amazon SDK, okay, to do the task that it is supposed to do. Okay, make sense or any doubts? Guys, any doubts, any questions, or does it make sense? It does not make sense, even that is fine. Okay, at least say no so yeah, that I get an idea that I'm audible or feels like that the connection is on. Okay.
With this, what you are showing demo, I couldn't clear.
Okay, so I will be setting up an application that is a web-based application, and this application will create a bucket in S3, then create a file in that bucket, and then show you the contents of that. That is the demo I'm showing.
Okay, from the web application, you are creating an object, you are creating a bucket and creating a object into that.
Yes.
Okay. Not from AWS console.
No. So if this is a web application, can somebody tell me what are the requirements to run a web application? Or what will be the requirements to run a web application?
Apache server, sir.
Apache server. Okay. Yes. This application requires PHP. because it is written in PHP. That is why we installed PHP. I'll show you where the PHP installation happened. This is updating it. I'll show you in the command. So here when I'm installing httpd, I'm also installing PHP. Okay, so both are being installed. Then this application uses AWS SDK. So here I'm setting up AWS SDK for PHP. AWS SDK for PHP. So I'm running PHP this command, which says that it requires AWS SDK for PHP. So it is installing that. In the screen, if you see, this is where it does that. Okay, logs. So using version for AWS SDK PHP, and it is installing and setting up everything. Okay. Now, again, since this is a web-based application, our first task is once the HTTP server is set up, we'll check it out whether it's working or not. Because if the HTTP server is not working, the rest of the stuff that we do, it's not going to work out. Okay, and then we'll be worried about like why that other stuff is not happening, and we'll be troubleshooting something which may not be an issue. So let's check it out whether that is working or not. So once we are sure that that is working, I'll show you what commands we'll be using or what will files we'll be using. I'll open those. So one is like create bucket. This. Then the second one is create file. We have another one as read file. We have another one as cleanup file. Okay, so we'll be using these four PHP files. Okay, I'll explain. So let me test out whether the server is or not. So this shows me a test page. So that means my web server is working. Okay, so this is the first test that you should always do when you go and set up Apache. Okay, because if you're not doing that test, if you're not doing this test, you will not know whether this is actually working. Okay. So we did this test. Then these are the programs that we'll be using. So create bucket, create file, read file, cleanup.php. So create bucket, if you see, it says include this. This will go and check the connection to AWS. Then it says define a unique ID. Unique ID should start with a number. So I can say Rishi, okay, Rishi class, and I can say June. So what this means is the bucket name should start with this and then add a unique ID to it. Okay, this is what it means. And then it is going to create a bucket with this name. So say create bucket. Bucket name is this, which is coming in from over here. Okay, it will do that. And once it does that, it is going to say, it will post me click here to continue. In click here to continue, it is going to call create file.php, which is a different file, which is here. So create file.php is again going to create a file whose name starts with say class June.txt. Okay, so the create file's names will be this, and I can call this, hey, it will print hello cloud box. We can write anything that we want. The body of that file will be this, but we can write whatever. Okay, now if you see here, it's click here to read your file. So here it is calling readfile.php, which is this, which is actually doing nothing, but is going to read the file and show you the contents, and cleanup.php is going to delete everything. Okay, so just to give you a very basic level of idea, like what we'll be doing. Yes, no, doesn't make sense. Okay, so let me move these files to the server, to the EC2 instance where I'll be using this. So I am at, if I do var www.html, because this is where we keep our files which are related to the site or related to the application, which can be accessed over the internet. So my file should be create, not create file. What is the name? Create bucket. .php. So these names are important because if we are not using the correct name, what happens is when the files are being called, it will create a problem. So we have to have the correct name. So I'll say create bucket.php. Then the next file is create file.php. So we'll say this create file.php. Okay. Then we have read file.php. So this will be reading the file that gets created. And we have cleanup.php. Cleanup.php is going to delete everything that got created. Okay, so we'll create this. Okay, so I did some stuff. Okay, I copied, I moved the contents. So this is like my application which is running, a PHP application. The purpose of the application is to create a bucket, then create a file, then show me the contents of the file, and then delete everything that happened. Okay, this is what I did. Now this application is running on an EC2 instance. Okay, this is running on an EC2 instance. So how do I access this? How do I make a call to create bucket.php? Yeah, any ideas? How do I call that file?
Hello.
Rishi,
in that text file context, when we are creating means like editing that text file like we did earlier in EC2 like index.html.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, that using that we can means same like we have to call this first file.
Did not get you. So the files are created. Text editor is VI that we are using, and I have the files created. So if I do ls, right, I will be able to see. You will be able to see all the files.
Okay. Yeah.
See, the files are created. Now when I say call the file, what I mean to say is that so if I copy the IP over here, I see this page. I don't want to see this page. I want to see my create bucket wala page. So how do I get to that page?
So you have to place that file in the where means like where www.html part.
It is there. Var www.html, the file is here. I can't hear what you said.
We need to push that file to the server.
It is on the server. Okay. So when I create this, when we had this file, when I had index.html, how did I access this file? I simply copy pasted over here the IP, and if I now refresh, it used to show me this. This is some spelling mistake, but I was able to get this. How this was working is, this is working because index.html is the default file that is called over here. So if I write this and hit enter, right, I see the same thing. Okay, if I write index.html and hit enter, I see the same thing. Why? Even without writing, I see the content of it because that is the default file that is accessed or that is opened whenever we access a web server. Okay.
Yes.
So how do I access other files? Say if I have to access test.php. So how do I access this? So it's simple. I simply copy and write it over here and it shows me what the contents of test.php. Okay. So how do I access create bucket.php? I simply copy this and add it over here. And hit enter. this is not going to work. So it says the page is not working. It's currently unable to handle the request. There is some error. Now, why this? Why this error? And I'll give you a hint, the concept lies somewhere in IAM and EC2.
Permission right.
What permission?
To create that bucket.
Okay, so where that permission needs to go?
User should have S3 access.
Yeah, EC2 instance should have that S3 full access permission.
How that is going to happen?
For the IAM user, whatever Rishi user, we need to create a S3 full access. You need to add that permission. So then we'll get this.
Which user, which permission? Okay, so S3 full access
Rishi,
permission needs to be added. Which user?
No, that Rishi, whatever we are creating under the Rishi, so that IAM user,
this is administrator. He has full access. This is the root account. It has full access. Say I can create a bucket from here. So that means I have access. This is not working. Yeah, it is related, something related to access, but what access? We are not going ahead until somebody tells me that. Yes, who is going to tell me what could be the problem? It is related to access. How do we give access to an EC2 instance to be able to access S3?
Maybe we can create an IAM role with S3 permissions. So we'll attach to that EC2 instance.
Okay. So what is the purpose of an IAM role?
So it is granting the permissions, temporary permissions to use that. It is nothing but granting the temporary permissions to use the AWS resources.
Granting temporary permissions to whom?
Like any IAM user. So whenever you create a user, we are giving the permissions to access some AWS resources.
Okay.
So that role we need to attach to the EC2 instance.
IAM user and IAM role are two different things.
Now what I'm saying is, so IAM role we need to create with the S3 full access, and that role we have to attach to EC2 instance.
I understood that, and I did that also. So I came in here, I attached an IAM role. I'll show you. This is the IAM role, which is named S3 read only, but it has S3 full access. I attach that role to the EC2 instance. I did that. Now you mentioned that something about an IAM user having an IAM role that we are attaching to the EC2 instance. I am saying IAM user and IAM role are two different things.
Yeah.
Yes. So what is the difference between an IAM role and IAM user? Others were able to understand what I just did, creating an IAM role and attaching to an EC2 instance. Why was that done? Any idea?
Sir, the IAM service is global, right? It is not region specific. So
okay.
If we can add user to IAM simply, I'm not sure it will work or not, but this could be tried.
So IAM is global. I'm okay with that. User will not work. The better way to do is we create an IAM role and we give that role to an EC2 instance. That is what I did. Okay, so I did it a bit fast, but what I did is I came in over here, I went to actions, instance settings, attached and replace this IAM role. And from the drop down, I had this S3 read only role. And I said apply. Okay, the role that I applied is called S3 read only. The name is S3 read only, but then I went to IAM. I'll show you what permissions it has. So it has S3 full permissions. I go to roles, I go to S3 read only, and you say it has Amazon S3 full access. It also has administrator access. Okay. So it has access. What access I need, it has. Now my question is, so Mahesh was saying something about an IAM user. My question is, what is the difference between an IAM user and an IAM role?
Like IAM user is like a normal user, like I, you, or anyone is the user, and IAM role is nothing but we are just creating a role and we are giving the permissions to that. We are giving the permissions and attaching it to any user or EC2 instance.
No, we are not doing that.
IAM role will be a global thing, like it can be attached to
an IAM user is also
more users.
A No.
Hello, hello, Rishi. IAM role is an identity with permissions.
Okay. So what is an IAM?
Yeah. Yeah, IAM
it's
user
a set
is
of permissions.
No. IAM user is means like
role.
IAM user is like a physical person, like the end user. Anyone is using the AWS resources.
Okay. What is a role?
Role means like the set of permissions like that we can assign to many users.
Isn't that policy?
Huh?
Is not that policy? Policy is a set of permissions that can be assigned to a user group or a role.
Yes.
Yes. So back to question one again, what is an IAM role? And how does it differ from an IAM user?
Rishi, IAM user cannot, means IAM user have rights to access AWS resources. Okay. Mm-hmm. And IAM roles have does not access to resources directly. Means IAM role is assigned to something, but it cannot access services, AWS services.
Okay. But aren't we doing the same thing? We have given an IAM role to an instance so that it can access an S3 service.
Rishi, one more. The IAM role is we can create a IAM role and we can give it to another account also. Like I have a AWS account and you are a AWS account. I can assign that IAM role to your account and still you will be able to access whatever the permissions related to that in my bucket or anywhere.
No. How many of you actually practiced anything related to IAM?
But this IAM role, we can use it, right, Rishi? Like I'll create one IAM role.
I agree on that. I am saying we can use IAM role. I also attached an IAM role. I'm saying the same thing. I attached an IAM role. I showed you what IAM role I attached.
Yeah.
I showed you all that stuff. I'm not saying IAM role cannot be used. My only question is like how an IAM role is different from a IAM user. That is the only question. There is no other
IAM
question.
Role is a component of the IAM user. Like IAM user is a supervisor kind, and that IAM role is a one component of that, including policy, then user and groups.
No. That is not the case.
Like IAM user can have many roles. But role will be one. for one kind of like, you know, no.
I'm waiting for the right answer, or at least an answer which is near to the correct one.
Hello.
Yes, I can hear you.
Sir, I am policy for I am user and I am role for a services, which is actually for EC2 testing. Only applicable. Roles for applicable for only resources and services. EC2 testing.
Can you come again?
Yeah, I am policy actually for a user and a role actually for a services like EC2 S3. It is not for not for a user actually role.
So what you are saying is that we cannot. We cannot give role a policy.
No, I mean to say that user policy that in I am role actually it's applicable to user, and a role is applicable to only services EC2 like EC2 instance and S3 buckets. Like,
I got that. But in that case, are you saying that a policy cannot be applicable to a role?
Yeah.
No, that is, so I just showed you a role which had a policy S3 full access associated to it. I showed you, right? I showed you a role which had a policy associated to it. You want me to show again?
But usually you told instead of like assigning directly policies to user, we used to create roles, and in under those role we used to assign policies, so that like we can when a user in, like in a organization, if some person joins, so initially we give them some kind of roles, right? And then
no,
we can
include
policies. No,
that is a group actually, so they will create a group and assign.
Yeah,
okay.
Group.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay. 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 So, I have noticed that all of you are very eager to get the recordings, but I now also realize that none of you are actually using the recordings, or none of you are actually practicing the concepts or getting through it. Okay. So. I think someone mentioned almost there, like an IAM user is mostly used, like some part somebody mentioned correct, some part someone else mentioned correct. IAM user is used when somebody is wants to access manually AWS resources, maybe the command line, maybe the console. And IAM role is used when we want one service, one AWS service to be able to access another AWS service. An IAM role is used when we want to enable one AWS service to be able to access another AWS service. Okay. In this case, what we are doing is we are enabling EC2 to be able to access S3. Okay. We are doing that. My application is running on an EC2 instance and it is trying to access S3. Okay. Now, let us go to IAM for a quick minute. If I am, so what I did for that, I connected an IAM role to my EC2 instance, which is this. Okay, this is an IAM role. And the purpose of this IAM role is so that EC2 instance is able to access S3. Fine. Yes, no?
Yeah.
That is the purpose. Now, if you are saying that this role, S3 read only, is helping EC2 to be able to access S3, that means this needs to have a policy which says S3 full access or S3 read only access, depending on what type of permission it requires. Sorry, I clicked on that. Okay, so this has S3 full access connected to it. If this policy is not there, how this role will help EC2 to be able to access S3? Getting it? So an IAM role is a feature using which I can enable one AWS service to be able to access another AWS service. An IAM user is very similar to an IAM role. We assign policies to users, we assign policies to roles, we assign policies to groups. Permissions are policies. What is a policy? A policy is a document that defines what permissions, what access rights a user, a group, or a role is getting. Now, remembering a bit about what role was. No, still not remembering?
Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
At least one yes. Okay. So coming back to my rant, see, it's very easy to forget. It's very easy to forget when you are learning something new. And it is easier to forget something new when you are only doing it on Saturdays and Sundays and not practicing it, or not revising it, or not going through the concepts. Believe me, by the time we finish S3 and we go to VPC, you will forget like 50% of EC2. IAM is already gone, and it is gone to an extent where watch the video. I think we have the recording. Watch it. You will see that I clearly mentioned that roles in real life mean what you have been explaining. In apart from, say, outside of AWS, a role means that is the permission that a user get. If it is an administrator role, it means the user is an administrator. Okay, this is what you are explaining, which I clearly said that means in real life. But in AWS, a role does not mean that. It has a completely different meaning, right? So please go through that recording again, clear your doubts, practice it out. And I assume that all of you are practicing EC2, because that if you start forgetting about EC2, it's going to be a big problem. Okay, coming back. So I was trying to access this page, create bucket, and it was saying this page is not working. Okay, so apart from the role problem, I went to the logs and noticed that it is saying failed opening connect to aws.php for inclusion, which is actually mentioned in the code. So create bucket, it says include connect to aws.php. So there was one file missing, okay, which was initializing AWS S3 client and all. So I created that file. So I'm not sure how many noticed. I created this file in the same place where other files are, because that was missing. Okay. Now if I go to and refresh, it says, hello box, you have successfully created a bucket called, which is starting with Neobog, and there is a unique ID. So let's check whether this got created or not. I'll refresh. So the bucket is created. Let's get inside the bucket. The bucket is empty. So our next step was, sorry, click here to continue. What happens when we do click here to continue? Here is the code. Click here to continue. It is going to call createfile.php. This file will be called. Okay, so let's try this. So it says file has been successfully uploaded to this bucket. So let's verify. So the file has been created. Okay. Now if I say click here to read your file. So let's open that create file. So click here to read your file will call readfile.php. So let's click over here. It will show me the no, it says readfile.php. Is missing. So let's see.
The file name was missing D. Yeah.
Yes. So we will change this. That is why I said that a small mistake and it is going to create issues. There's again a spelling mistake. So let's correct it out. Readfile.php and let's refresh this. So it now shows stuff. Now it says click here to remove files and buckets. So if I now click on this, it has deleted everything. Goodbye. So let's just verify again whether it actually deleted or not. So if I refresh this again, so it cleared it. Okay. So the purpose of the application is like this is a 4-page application, 4 or 5 pages are there. And the purpose what? Create a file, create a bucket, create a file, show you the contents of the file, and then clear out everything. Okay, just to give you an idea that if you are using a web-based application that in the background is doing something on S3, how that can be achieved. So the important stuff is how you are going to set up a web server, which most of you are well aware of how that happens. Then depending on what language you are using, if you are using Java, if you are using Python, whether you are using .NET, whether you are using PHP, you will require the SDK for that language. AWS SDKs are available for most of the languages. So whether you are using even Go, Go is a very new language, there is an AWS SDK available. That needs to be set up on the server. Then since you are automatically doing something on S3, your server needs to have access to S3, okay, which is done using a role, using an IAM role that needs to be associated to the server, okay. And then whenever your application is accessing S3, it will be able to show you the contents of it, okay, or maybe whatever operation you are doing, that will go. In case there is some issue. Okay, so where do you go and check the logs? So Linux, the logs are stored in /var/log. Okay, if you go inside this directory, you can see all the logs. Okay, so all the logs that are generated are stored over here. Now our service is HTTPD, so that is why I went inside this directory and I did an ls. So it has access log and error log. Any error that is coming will be stored in error log. So if I do this, it has like warning, notice, warning. All those details will be stored over here. Anything related to access will be stored in the other. So if I do this, it says get this. These are all get operations that were performed on these files. Okay. Just to give you a small idea on where you can go and check the logs for. Any doubts with what we just did?
No.
Okay, others? Any doubts, any questions?
No, Ruchi.
Okay, all of you are on the same page before we move ahead with VPC.
So I will get your videos and I'll go through the videos since this is the first class I'm attending.
Okay. Okay. Okay, fine. So, okay, let me ask you all of you a question. Do you feel comfortable moving ahead with VPC, or do you guys want to practice out all that we have done up till now during this week and then start VPC next Saturday?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, go ahead.
We will practice it out and then we should move for VPC.
Okay.
Yes, Rishi.
We'll start VPC next week. Okay, so 2 votes. Others, what do you say?
Yeah, we want to do a revision from IAM to S3.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay. So I'm okay with that. No problem. Do the revision. So why I ask this question is because say if on a scale of 1 to 10, EC2, 10 being the most difficult, EC2 was at 8, right? 8 or maybe 9. BPC will be 20 on the scale of 1 to 10. Okay. This will talk about entire networking concepts that are there in AWS. Okay. I'll give you a small overview. We still have like lots of time. I won't start anything new. we have been working with security groups all through, right? We use security groups a lot, correct? Yeah.
Yes.
Now in security groups, whenever we added a rule, we always defined 0000000 whenever we added a rule, correct? We have been doing this. Now, some of you also notice that when 000 is allowed and then EC2 instance is being launched, at the end it gives a warning that your server security is open to the world. Remember? I'll show you what I'm talking about.
Yes, I remember.
Okay. Yeah. I'll still show you.
Because we are using that 00, which is the public IP address, and we are not specifying a particular IP address. So it says that anybody can access your EC2 instance.
Okay, not exactly. It is a public IP address.
Yeah, zero means right from 0 to 255, like 3.7 billion people, where is that IP address is having, they can access.
Okay. So it says this. Yeah, this is what I was saying. Your security group is open to the world. Fine. This was the error I was talking about. Okay. Now, coming back to the question. So Mahesh said that it means like some billion people can access, will be able to access if I specify 000. So how on earth will 000 or is 000 being compared with everyone that is available on the internet? Why this means everyone on the internet? Or first of all, let's not even go there. What is this notation called? Is this an IP address?
Yes, looks like.
This is, we write IP addresses like this, 192.168.something.something. We don't write with a slash, right?
Yeah,
slash zero is, I think it is an internal AWS VPC, internal AWS port, something.
Right now you are saying that this means the public IP address and
it means
everyone can access. Now you are saying this is internal to AWS. So both things cannot be true, right?
Yeah.
It's either internal or it's external.
No, that 000 is for public IP address. In return, it might redirect to AWS network something. I feel
no.
I don't know.
No.
Okay.
The thing after slash was CIDR block notification.
Okay.
Which is used to define how many IPs the IP address will be using or how many IPs will be permitted for that.
Okay. So not
and
the thing after zero means CIDR. This notation is called CIDR. Yes, you are saying something more.
Okay.
You are saying something more.
Yeah, that only. Okay.
So this, the.
Yeah,
this
I was saying
hard.
That total of 64 IPs can be defined. And if we want to define, suppose 32 IPs, so accordingly, we have to change the CIDR block notification.
64, 32 IPs, no, not exactly.
I was saying that we need to divide the number after slash so as to define how many IPs will be used, whether it is public or private.
No, we don't divide that number by anything. This is CIDR notification. CIDR full form is classless inter-domain routing, CIDR. Okay, so let's say, if I say edit in a rule and say add rule, and say I do mock 3, and I don't give anything over here. and it'll say save CIDR block. Okay, so this notation is called as CIDR block or CIDR block notation, the way of writing. Okay, this is CIDR. Now, how this means all the IP addresses in the world. We won't go into VPC, I'll just explain you like what this is.
The first three zeros, I think, 0.0.0. Is that always constant?
No.
And the fourth zero may vary from 0 to 63.
No.
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 Richie, because of slash zero.
Because of slash zero, what happens? Because of slash zero. What? Because of slash zero? I did not get you.
Because of slash zero, it will be mismatching all the IPs.
But why? It matches all the IP because of slash zero, but why? Why slash zero means all the IPs? Okay. No issues. Okay. So, why this as an this is an IP4 address? IPv4 address, that we all agree, right?
Yes.
Let me write something more sensible. Say 192.33.289.356. This looks correct, or there is some problem?
Yes.
This is correct. How many of you think this is correct?
No, I have not seen like this before. I have just seen up to four zeros and one digit after the slash.
No. Okay, so confusion. I have written two IP addresses. This is separate.
Okay.
Leave aside.
Okay.
I have written this IP address. Okay. How many of you think this IP address is correct? How many of you think there is some problem with this IP?
Yeah, 192 is correct.
There is some problem.
356. The entire thing I'm asking whether this is correct or there's a problem.
This is wrong. In the last docket, there is a 356.
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah. What it
last
should be?
One cannot be 356.
Okay.
It up to 254.
It can only be 254.
255.
Then the second last one also is wrong, right?
Yeah.
Okay. So why it cannot be more than 254?
Because its IP address is 32-bit address.
Okay. Why it is 32-bit?
Every octet there is a 8-bit. So it is not a possibility to, more than 256 or 50.
Okay, so now somebody is talking sense. An IP4 address is called an IP4 address because it is made up of four octets of 8 bits each. So this dot this, these are four octets. Okay, one octet, two octet, three octet, four octet. Why these are called octets? Because these are all 38 bits in size. Each part of an IP4 address is 8 bits in size. Okay, so that means 8 bits here, 8 bits here, 8 bits here, 8 bits here. Okay, so if you have 8 bits, if you have maximum 8 bits, okay, what is the biggest number that you can generate with 8 bits? What is the biggest number that can be generated with 8 bits? So that there is a formula. The formula is 2 base to the power of how many numbers you want to generate. In this case is 8. What is that? That is 256. So that means you cannot have numbers greater than 256 in an octet, or you can have numbers 0 to 256 only, 255, sorry. You cannot have less than 0, you cannot have more than 255. Okay. Okay, making sense till this point of time?
Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
Now, somebody mentioned 32. So how come 32 comes into picture? 32 is, how do we know there are how many IP4 addresses? So we simply add all the octets. What the number we get is 32. We raise 32 to the power of 2. This gives us 65,536 into 65,536 IP addresses, which is almost finished. That's why we moved to, or we are moving to, I won't say we are moving to IP. Which V6. Version are we moving to? IP8?
IPv6.
Okay, which has a completely different format, right? So, an IP4 address is made of 4 octets of 8 bits in size. One octet can only be maximum 256. The total IP address that can be generated with an IP4 address is 2 raised to the power 32, which is this many IP addresses. Okay. Okay. Now, what happens when we write 0.0.0.0/0? Why this means all the IP addresses that are available? So to calculate the number of IP addresses that can be formed via a CIDR block, we do this. We raise 2 to the power of 32 minus n. N is the number that is written over here. Okay, sorry, something missed. So 2 raised to the power 32 minus n. So if here it is written as 16, how many IP addresses can be formed from it? 2 raised to the power 16. If here I write 32, how many IP addresses can be formed from it? 2 raised to the power 32 minus 32, that is 0. That is 1. If I write 0 over here, how many IP addresses can be formed from it? 2 raised to the power 32, which is all the IP addresses that are available on the planet, right? Now, this applies only when we have 0.0.0.0 written. This will not apply when we write 1.1.1.1/0. This is wrong. I cannot do that. Why I cannot do that? Because I have selected a number. I have removed one possibility of IP address which was being generated from this. So I cannot write a 0. 0 can only be used when I am writing 0.0.0.0/0. Okay. I cannot use /0 as soon as I start writing a number. 0.0.0/8/0, not going to work because I have selected one number. /0 only works when the others are 0. Okay. Okay. Not okay.
Okay.
Too much on a Sunday evening. So see, whatever doubts are coming, you have to get it clarified. If you're not getting any doubts, that is well and good. But even if you are getting a slightest of doubt, you should get it clarified. Because this is where the concept of VPC, if you are not clear with this, right, creating a VPC is going to be a big problem. Then we'll be creating subnets. Then we'll be defining route tables. Then we'll be working with security groups again. It's going to be a big problem if this is not clear.
Rishi, this I didn't get. 2 raised to 32 minus n. What is that n actually?
This.
Like whatever the number 16, 8, 32, so that will be replaced by 32 minus that number.
Yes.
This is for IPv6, right?
Where did I see I say IPv6?
But normally this one is like earlier you mentioned 2 raised to power 32, that one is IP address, but this slash n is a new one, right? That's why.
That is CIDR. If you write, if you use anything after slash, that makes the notation as CIDR notation. Where did I mention IP6 except writing it over here?
Yeah.
No place I talked about IP6.
Yeah.
It's everything about IP4 only. Forget IP6. IP6 is a lot more complex as compared to IP4. Okay, yeah. Okay, if no clarifications on this, I will stop here and we will continue from here for the next class. When we start VPC, I'll come back to this again. This has a lot more concepts. Okay, I just gave you an overview like what this used to mean. We used to write this and used to say that your security group is open to the world. It was open to the world because this means all the IP4 addresses that are possible on the planet. Okay, which means anybody on the on Earth who has internet can access your server. That is why whenever you are setting up a security group rule, you never go give 0000/0. That becomes a problem. Except in the case of a website. Okay, except in the case of a website where you want everybody to be able to access, you don't give, otherwise you don't give 000/0. Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. Okay. Yes, you are going to ask something.
Rishi, this S3 is finished. Is it like?
S3 is done, yeah.
Okay, and for the practice, we will need the PHP files. Now, can you share with us those files? We will try it.
It's there on the
.php
drive
file.
That, no, it's there on the drive that I have shared, but the drive is still not shared.
The drive is still
so
not shared.
So you can put there.
Drive is still not shared. Okay, I'll check with Rupali today, and I'll share the drive by today.
I've shared one drive which has the video. I will share that with you, Rishi, so that you can add your stuff. I mean,
okay.
Your content.
It's already there. It's already there in the one of the drives. So I'll share the link instead of copying it from one place.
Okay.
Fine.
Yeah. SDK file also we will need now. We will need SDK also.
SDK can be downloaded.
Okay. Okay.
Okay.
Okay.
Any other questions on this or on S3? See, one thing just remember that if a topic is finished, it does not mean we will not be using the concept from that topic in the other services. So to give you an idea, as we are progressing, we will be utilizing, we will be adding on the concepts that we studied in the first class. We keep on revisiting region and availability zones, right? Similarly, everything that we studied, we will be keep revisiting that. We will be building on top of it so that when we are done with the course, it's not like you studied services individually and you are not able to connect to them, okay? Right, you will be able to connect all the services. You will be able to think how services work in tandem with each other. That should be the end goal, and that is what we are trying to do, right? So you should take out time and practice everything out, else it starts becoming a challenge, right? So please take out some time, practice all the stuff that we have done till now, and then next Saturday we'll start with VPC. Okay. Okay. Yes, no.
Okay,
sir. Yes, Rishi.
Yeah, okay. Okay then, see you next Saturday. Practice all. Yeah, I've shared a drive link, by the way, for you guys.
So all the previous videos will also be there in that drive link?
No, the videos are in a different drive. The slides are in a different drive.
Okay.
Okay.
Hello, sir.
Yes.
Is there any snowball or storage gateway inside S3? Or is it different part?
Snowball is a different concept. Storage gateway is a different concept. So to give you a small overview, Snowball is used to migrate data from your data center to AWS or from AWS to your data center. If you have say some 500, 600 terabytes of data, maybe a few petabyte of data, so you can go to Snowball. There is a console. So on the services, on the AWS console, if you go and search for Snowball, it will take you to a service. You have to request for a Snowball device. It is like a briefcase, like a trolley bag, similar to a trolley bag that we use to keep our luggage in when we are traveling. Okay. And one single Snowball device can support 80 terabytes of storage. That device is sent to your data center, and then data can be backed in into the Snowball device. Once the data backup is complete, the device is sent back to AWS, and then they download that data to your S3 bucket. Okay, so that is, this device is used to increase the speed or to simplify the way your data transfer is happening on AWS. Okay, otherwise think about, you are migrating 80 terabytes of data, just an example. It will probably take an year, even with a very good internet connection, to upload 80 terabytes of data onto AWS. Okay, so whenever you have huge amounts of data, to upload that data or to migrate that data to AWS, you can use Snowball. Okay, apart from Snowball, there is another service called as Snow Mobile. Snow Mobile is a exabyte scale data transfer service. Snowball is a petabyte scale. Snow Mobile is an exabyte scale data transfer service. Works in a similar way. When you have to migrate huge amounts of data from your data center to AWS, or vice versa, from AWS to your data center, they even do that. There is a charge associated, but yeah, that is where it is used. It has no relation to S3. Okay.
Okay, sir. Thank you.
Yeah. Okay. So, if no other questions, we'll break for today and meet next Saturday. Just a heads up: this opportunity will not be coming again. So please practice all that stuff out which we have done previously, so that you are up to date when we are talking about PPC next.
Okay.
Yeah.